Dr. James L. Wheeler here, president and founder of Mighty FGCC Bible College and Theological Seminary in this country and abroad. Our television money, yeah, money and ministry, Sunday, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., Monday, 10 to 12 a.m., Wednesday, 12 to 2 p.m., Wednesday, 9 to 11 p.m., Thursday, 12:30 to 1:30 p.m., Saturday from 1 to 2 p.m., and Saturday again from 7 to 8 p.m. Those are our television ministry time on Channel 17, and we're coming real soon to Kalamazoo, and we'll let you know what we're going to do when we get on in Kalamazoo. I am Pastor Dr. James L. Wheeler. Lord, I thank you for your loving kind and your tender mercy. Ain't nobody like you. Took us a lifetime to find it out, but we know now for ourselves. You're God all by yourself. You can make the crooked straight, make the rough smooth. Take the sin out of the heart of man and put the Holy Spirit in there. You are man's deliverer and keeper and saver and helper. We thank you for your loving kind and your tender mercy. You are God all by yourself. And we love you. We love you in Jesus' name. Thank you for healing the sick, giving eyesight to the blind, raising the dead, rebuking the devil, giving peace to our spirits, saving our relatives way yonder somewhere t'other. You're that kind of God, and we thank you. Thank you for your love, your kind, and your tender mercy. We thank you. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen. Amen, amen. Amen. We're going to teach you about God's goodness. You know God is a good God. We're going to teach a subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. We're going to begin our teaching in Psalms 1. We've been there for a while. Don't have to go nowhere. All the word is the same. Psalms 1. Blessed is the man that walk not in the counsel of the ungodly. That's how you get blessed. Not standing in the way of sinners. Not sitting to see the scornful. Look at the condition to be blessed in Psalms 1:2. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law do he meditate day and night. Look at the stability of holiness in Psalms 1:3. And it should be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth his fruit in his season. His leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he do shall prosper. The ungodly is not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord know the way, good God Almighty. For the Lord know the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Look at Psalms 107. We're teaching a subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. Psalms 107. Our subject is found in Psalms 107. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For what reason? Well, he's good. And beside that, his mercy endureth forever. The word endure means won't go away no matter what you do to it. He's going to always be merciful. Even when you sin, he'd be so merciful, you'll come back. Now that's Psalm 107 and 2. So why don't we repeat what we read in Psalms 107 and 1. Let the Redeemer of the Lord say that his mercy endureth forever. Whom had redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Now when the devil get a grip on you, you need God. I say you need God. He won't break you loose. He'll call you and his voice will give you power to leave from where you were to where you should be. Let the redeemed of the Lord say, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he had redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Did God have to deliver you from the enemy? Hand of the enemy means the works of the enemy. And gather them out of the land from the east, from the west, from the north, and from the south. Now, there are no other directions. You got to be east, north, south or west or someplace. They wandered in the wilderness in a solitary way. They found no city to dwell in. God drove them out because of their disobedience. Psalm 107 and 5, hungry and thirsty, their souls fainted in them. But that's not for bread and water. That's for the nurture of obedience. Look what happened now. Following the fifth verse. They were hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Now the next word in Romans 107 and 6 say, then. What do you mean then? Well, when they was hungry and thirsty. They didn't look to no sky. They didn't think it was beginning to rain. No, that's a human statement. Psalm 107 and 6, hungry and thirsty. Their soul fainted in them. Faint means to die of thirst from the presence or the absence of the presence of God. Look what they did. They made a difference in their life. Romans 107 and 6. Then, when they were hungry and thirsty, when their soul fainted in them, then at that point, so it don't ever get too bad for God, then they cried unto the Lord. Look, in their trouble. You can call on Lord in trouble. Now, there ain't no time in your life when you don't got some kind of problem. Then they cried unto the Lord in their trouble. Look. And he delivered them out of their distress. What will trouble do? Distress you. When you distress, you call upon the name of the Lord, he'll deliver you from it. He doesn't do that with the choir. He does it with his son Jesus. God the Father sent God the Son to make us sons. But God's Son had to die to give us a right to live. There's, he swapped his life for our death. Now that's beyond the mind. That's beyond the mind. Why would the lamb die for the one that hate him? That's beyond the intellectual understanding. But the scriptures say God so loved the world that he gave his only Father, Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We're teaching a subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. We're in Psalms 107. Psalm 107:4 said, they wandered in the wilderness in a solitary place where there wasn't nobody there but them. They found no city to dwell in. They were in the wilderness. And there they hungered and thirst. Their soul fainted in them. They had bread and water. But the scripture said, O taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalms 107:5, hungry. Now, the job of the devil is when you're in the world to feed you worldly stuff. But you can eat all the worldly stuff that the world can afford you. But that doesn't mean your soul is enjoying it. Because they ate, but they were hungry. They drunk, but they were thirsty. So they must not be talking about bread and water. The scripture said Jesus is the bread of life. And the word of God said, oh, taste and you will see that the Lamaha, that the Lord is mucho bueno, good, maknavi vonduba. He is good. But you'll have a hard time trying to taste something before you get it in your mouth. What does the scripture say? Oh, taste, and you'll what? See. So you see with the taste buds of your will. So the scripture really is saying, get Jesus on the inside and you'll know for yourself. Yep, he's good. And his mercy didn't do it for ever. So you can quote that scripture on the way to the crack house. So what does one spiritual sight come from? Whatever he tastes. Taste and you will see that the Lord is good. Your tongue can't taste and see. Your soul have to taste and your spirit will see. Yep, he's good. Give me some more. If that be the case now, how can you get angry when somebody preach 2 hours? Because I ain't talking to you. That don't apply to you. And when you taste in Jesus that gives you life, where you're watching your clock, you just want 10 minutes of life or something? What? People notice time because that's where the devil lives. Salvation took the church up out of time into eternity. And eternity don't consider time. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. And the fifth verse in Psalm 107 showed the condition of those that left God because of disobedience. Hungry. Now, bad enough to be hungry. But they hungry and thirsty. And because they hungered, was hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted. Their spirit was about to die because of their absence from God. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you what? Life. They went away from God. They were thirsty. And they hungered. So they came, and God gave them life. Sixth verse in Psalms 107. Then they cried unto the Lord. Look, in that trouble, if you got a problem, God see the problem. But it's not going to touch it until you cry for help. Now, you see people committing suicide, they jump in the water, they don't say nothing. But the person that don't want to drown, help, help, help! The scriptures say, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, what? Shall be saved from the water of damnation and destruction. So they were thirsty and dry and hungry and empty. But that thirst is the thirst of what they used to have. That hunger was for the righteousness that they had that they do not have. And God recognized now their desire to get from him what they had before they left him. And God met them at their request. This is where you get this statement, a prayer request. Not a prayer beg. You don't have to beg God. A little simple thing. Lord, help me. Now, there ain't never a time you don't need these three words. Lord, help me. To get saved, Lord, help me. To stay saved. There'll never be a time or a place that you don't need Jesus. When you get to heaven, he's going to lead you out to living waters. Now on earth, he is your water. So this hellish musician made a statement. If you thirsty and dry, look to the skies, beginning to rain. That ain't in this book. It's beginning to rain, 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 rain. Jesus said, until I come, give yourself to fasting, praying, and the reading of this word. In the word of God, he said, you think you have life. Read it and eat it. It will become the bread of life. Never mind the crowd. The crowd's not going to heaven. So if you're seeking for a church with 20,000 members, you're going to miss God. Straight and narrow is the way that lead to righteousness, and few there be. Just a few. To be thereof. Now he didn't limit it to the few. The multitude limited to a few. But hell is not going to have as many souls in it as heaven. Because somebody penned this song, gathering in the sheeps, la, 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 gathering in the sheeps. And you hear the chief lamb standing at the door of heaven saying, whosoever will, let him come. So that whosoever can be everybody. But that everybody that come got a will to come. He said, come and drink the waters of life freely. This word is the water of life. So if you thirsty and dry, don't look to no sky. If it's beginning to rain, it ain't rained yet. No, no. Jesus is the water and the bread of life. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. And we're in Psalms 107. And we're going to read this word beginning at the beginning of Psalms 107. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For what reason, Holy Ghost? Well, he's good. How do you know that? Well, it's mercy. Keep on enduring our inabilities. You know Jesus can see what you can't see. You can formulate your thought, but that's something that motivates that formulation. When it's in process of formulating, God see every soul of it, every part of it, every little grit of it. He know. And he know the source that is formulating what you think. Because it was God that said, as a man think in his heart, so is he. So where does a man's thought start? In his heart. Not in your head. You came here as a baby knowing nothing. You didn't even know who your mother was. So the parents' job is to indoctrinate the children concerning God the Father. And if the mother and the father's not saved, somebody got to teach that child. The scripture says, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, God have ordained perfect praise. They don't have to speak the language. Their soul talks to God because they just left him the other day. Our subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. This ministry is growing like heaven's fire. It is growing. It is growing. We are coming on now in Kalamazoo. So Dr. Emma Moore is doing her job. Amen. Now our job is to give her something to put out there. And we're good at doing our job too. We'll tell anybody, whosoever will, let them come and drink the waters of life freely. And you come up with simple statements, you know God sure is a good God. That will work anywhere. If people receive the fact good God part. When you stop writing your prayers down so you can read them before Congress, when you stop staying up all night looking for a message, not knowing you are the message, when you stop staying up all night looking in the library, your heart is the library, because that's where God lives if you've shown up saved. Jesus said, "Think not what you will say in that hour. I, the Lord Jesus, will give you what I want you to say." So meditate, praise, worship. But you can't study up on a message. He that have an ear to hear, let him hear what the Lord say to the church. Not your natural ear. One of the prophets say, "My soul do magnify the God of my salvation." It's an inside job. And your heart can rejoice so deep and so tall and so big till your mind be saying, what? The scriptures say God is so good, he's beyond finding out. There's no way you can measure how good God is. But the scriptures say, God is good, and that my soul know right well. So praising God is an inside job. And when you praise God from the inside, oftentimes you're going to praise God in the number of a few people. You ain't never seen a choir where everybody in that choir is saying, So don't try to get praises and hallelujah from the melody. Get praises and hallelujah from your maker. His name is Jesus. In this book, say he stick closer than a brother. And I just heard God say, I'm as close to you as you permit me to be. So when God comes to coming close to you, he must feel like he's welcome approaching you. So he used your desire for him as a highway to come into you. And that highway is a two-way street. Because he said, whosoever will, what? Let him come. So you meet God with repentance. Lord, I'm sorry. So that thing left. So God's thinking, for what? For what? See, when you repent, that thing you repented concerning just disappeared. I don't care what it is. I don't care how big it is. Long as it's not blaspheming the Holy Spirit, God will forgive you instantaneously. But we come to repentance slowly sometime. Took me 34, 35 years to get serious with God. But the instant I was conceived, God was serious with me. And this book says, as soon as babies grow up, They go about lying. Now, what is the opposite to a lie? The truth. Why didn't the Bible say, as soon as they grow up, they go about speaking the truth? Because of their nature. Got that from the flesh of their father and their mother. So you have to be born again out of the likeness of your natural parents into the likeness of your heavenly father. It's not a complicated thing. Three words to get it done. Lord, help me. You ain't going to hear coming like that. No, no. Your mind might hear that. But he is as close to you as your desire for him. I'm teaching now. I said, I'm teaching now. I said, I'm really teaching now. I'm in Psalms 107. My subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. Why should you do that? Well, he's good. What's another reason? Well, his mercy endured. Endure means put up with enough to acknowledge that. He said, I will take your sins and I will put them behind me. When you put yourself before me, not in head of them, in front of them, right here in front of them. If you see Jesus eye to eye and confess heart to heart, he will save your soul instantaneously. Now, you don't have to act no particular way. You don't have to feel no particular way, but you must be thankful. Lord, I thank you for your love and kind and tender mercy. Your love, kind, and tender mercy. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Lord, I thank you for your word that came to save my soul. Don't move away from good statements that is repetitive. People keep on saying it. You know God sure is a good, don't move away from that. Put something else to it. My God sure is a good God. I love the Lord, he heard my cry, my Lord Almighty. Now let me tell you something. Before you begin to love the Lord, he had to have you hear your cry or you wouldn't be saved. There are two types of Lord, help me. The first one, get me saved. That second one, Lord, help me, keep me safe. Because the devil's job is to juggle us. And he's a bad juggle. And God is a good savior. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. I keep telling you, I'll be 78, 10 days from now. I'm going to tell you till you hear me. I don't got no pain nowhere. Now, you just wait till you get 78 and you know what I'm talking about. Now, I need to, for you to tell me what the name of the man was that did that. What's his name? And my Bible says, at the name of Jesus, every devil trembles. Now, sickness is not a devil. Amen. And all healthy people ain't godly. Amen. So you have to discern for yourself, because you're not really healthy until you receive the doctor of your spirit. You ain't really healthy until your soul gets saved. That's spiritual health. Spiritual health is heaven's rest. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I take that heaviness away, and I give you my son that is your rest. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord, and we're in Psalms 107. The fifth verse said, hungry and thirsty. Look what was hungry and thirsty in Psalm 107 and 6. That soul was hungry and thirsty, and that soul fainted in them. That's where your soul is, in you. So when you neglect God, when you reject God, when you turn your back to God, your soul will starve to death. But they did something about it. In the sixth verse in Psalms 107, then they cried unto the Lord. What's the next three words in Psalm 107 and 6? In their trouble. When you're in trouble, there ain't but one person can really help you. The Lord. And when they cried unto the Lord in Psalms 107 and 6, the Lord heard them and delivered them out of their distress. What is the purpose of sin? To distress you. For I got sweetly saved, I played my saxophone in them joints. They would hire a comedian, and he would make the people laugh. But because their mind wasn't distressed, but their spirit was distressed, when he'd tell him that joke, it would die just like that. It's just like stepping out of a warm room outside in sub-zero weather. That's like backslide. But you can step out of that sub-zero weather into a warm room. It's just like being born again. Because outside, you had a cold, hard heart. God's job is to warm your heart with his son, Jesus. When you're outside in the cold, you'll act like you're cold, because you've been affected by the thing that you're in. When you come out of the cold into the house, you'll be affected by the warmness of your new location. Oh, taste and see. that the Lord is good. Now, the goodness of God, that same scripture say, for his mercy endureth. So what does mercy do to a soul that's not merciful? Endure it, put up with it, be ready to save it. Then another scripture will come aboard. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Now, if the joy of the Lord is your strength, the devil's job is not to attack your joy, because the joy of the Lord is in your soul, and the devil cannot touch your soul. But you can get as saved as Jesus, the devil, with your permission, will address your mind. But it's not the thought in your head that affects you. But this Bible says, as a man thinking is what? Hard. The thoughts come from your spirit. You know God sure is a good God. Now you can say that with your mouth and your head can take part. But you can say it with your mouth and the soul will say, yeah, he's mighty good. How you know soul? Well, he good to me. When I was hungry, he fed me. He ain't talking about no hamburger. Did you know you get enough word in your heart and your heart can command your lips? Oh, singing to the Lord a new song. Your heart can demand your lip. Praise him now. Your heart also can put his foot on your lip. Shh. Yeah, but shh. Hush. Somebody wrote a song. Somebody calling your name. This business of being saved is heaven's business on earth. Now, salvation on earth is the only business heaven got. Now, your peace, your joy, your health, your long suffering, your forgiveness, it is the product of your salvation. If you're not saved, you don't even love yourself. If you did, you wouldn't put that dope in your veins. Say amen, somebody. I ain't backing up. When I was among the fools, I act like a fool. When I became one of the saints, I put away those foolish things. We need to interpret this book literally. The devil came to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So whatever he gives you, don't take it. It got fever on it, death and destruction on it. But this Bible says, come unto Jesus. He will give you everlasting life. You got to know your directions. It ain't Bible, but I used to hear my old grandpa say, boy, everything that feel good ain't good. Now, when God give us instructions, most of the time, Your flesh don't like it. Something that make you angry. And the Holy Ghost says, shh. You be saying, what? Did you see what they did? Listen to me. Before you get saved, you need to get this. The Holy Spirit will tug after your heart. Once you get saved, he don't do no more tugging. He will talk to your heart. No, y'all didn't get that. The Holy Spirit job before you get saved is to draw you. Once you get sweetly saved, his job is to keep you. He draw you with his words. He draw you with his power. He keeps you with his presence. I'm teaching tonight. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. Now, before I got sweetly saved, I used to sing this song. If I ever needed the Lord before, I sure do need him now. I sure do need him now. Oh, yes, I sure do need him now. But see, I didn't know what salvation was. So I didn't know what the goodness of God was. I didn't know what deliverance was. I really didn't know I needed him because I was lost. So you can put that preposition in there. If I ever needed the Lord before. And you leave that part off and say, I sure need him now. I need him every day, every second, every minute, every hour. Our subject is giving God thanks. Let me tell you something. When you make the first step going out of here, it's only because the grace of God. When you make up your mind I'm gonna live holy if all hell break loose. Let me tell you something. When you make up your mind to live holy, that's the time hell break loose. Hell don't want you holy. Write that down, boy. All that mercy on my soul. But I heard God say, whosoever will, what, in spite of all hell, what? Let him come. Your will is your power to come to God at any age. Jeremiah wasn't but 8. Go to it, I'll show you something. Jeremiah 1. He was 8 years old. Jeremiah 1 say, the words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were at Antioch in the land of Benjamin. So you can't confuse this locale. He'd tell you exactly where he was, what land he was in, when. Jeremiah 1:2. To whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. Told you exactly when he spoke to Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah wasn't but 8 years old. Jeremiah 1 and 2. To whom the word of the Lord came. Now, don't run over that. Hold it right there. He was 8 years old. He knew nothing. He never heard from God. But the word of the Lord came. Are you listening to me? So if I want you to hear from God, what must I do? Read. This is what God said. And you don't have to say, well, I don't know. But somebody told me. That ain't in this book. There are no fleshly feelings and fleshly emotion associated with what God said. There's spiritual feelings, spiritual emotion to what God said. So here's Jeremiah, 8 years old, in Jeremiah 1. To whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah. Josiah didn't hear the word. The son of Amon, king of Judah. Look, when did it come? In the 13th year of his reign. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Joachim, king of the Jews. You see all them important folk there? And God going to speak to an eight-year-old boy that never heard his voice before? Angie and her husband, she got pregnant. I started laying my hands on her stomach before her stomach started getting big. I said, hey, little baby boy. Hey, little baby boy. The first time she brought that baby to church, I said, hey, little baby boy. He looked right at me. Now, that's a wonder. That's a wonder. There are some things that just simply too big for us because it ain't none of our business. Because the Lord Jesus said, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, I, Jesus, have ordained perfect praise. They can't even walk yet. That's too big for you. Too big for you. Jeremiah 1. 1 and 2, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. It came also, see the word of God coming to Jeremiah more than once. Now you listen to me real good. This book say, study. They show yourself approved unto God. A workman have no need to be ashamed. Rightly. Dividing this word of truth. God is in here now. He was in here when we got here. He's going to go with us when we go and stay here and be here when we get back. The word is omnipresent. O-M-N-I. P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E, omnipresent. He's all-powerful, omnipotent. He's all wisdom, omniscient. Omni means all. Mm-hmm. Now you know this Jesus that so smart. How can we think we can say stuff he can't understand? And he hear the thoughts while they're being formed in your intellect. And whether that thought please God or not, your soul have to weigh it on the scale of holiness. You know your soul is a scale. Anything heavy get on it, you just let it fall off. Trouble, pain, problem, huh? Not disobedient children. You let them fall under the rod. Uh-huh. This is the first half of our subject, giving thanks unto God. And we thank you for coming to the church tonight and hearing us repeat to you, you know God sure is a good God. So we pause to give God thanks. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So this is a pause break. When we take a little side of praise and say, Lord, I thank you for your love and what? Kind and tender mercy. Now back to the second half of our study. Our study subject being giving thanks unto the Lord. And we have to take our intellect out of the position so our mind won't think that we keep saying the same thing. We keep saying the same thing about a God that's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So if he's the same, how come we're going to say something different? Huh? When you're in math class, it ain't time to take English. You're going to flunk that class. The subject at hand is the infallible word of God that can heal all your ills if you will obey. So we're on the second half now of our praise strip, headed for home plate, and we are in Jeremiah 1, teaching that God can use a soul at any age, and the devil can use a soul at any age too. You ever had your little 3-year-old baby to embarrass you in company? Pick them up by the heels, turn them upside down, and set the tail on fire. Don't punish them. That's not what I'm saying. Put the rod to them. Because if you don't, the Bible says you'll spoil that child. Bring up a child. Yes, sir, it's in the book. Bring up a child in the way they ought to go. And when they get old, God said it, and I ain't going to take it back. They will not depart. Our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. Now, if you think that subject is not important, the next time somebody tell you how good God is, when it comes out of a sanctified heart and a soul-controlled lip, try to control yourself. God is good sometimes. I know that, right. See, you have to know it for yourself. You must know it for yourself. There ain't no such thing as a hearsay good. This Bible put it this way, oh, taste, and you will see. That the Lord said to hey, hey, that the Lord is good. Now, I know how that chocolate candy look. It didn't say look and you will see. Because you're using your senses. The Holy Ghost said, oh, taste, and your eyes will be open. You will see that, whoo, my God, Jesus is good. Now, you know you're trying to get nobody there until you elevate that taste buds. They got to hungry and thirst after righteousness. Keep on talking so you can generate the hunger. But they ain't going to see till they taste. You can testify till you get 9 feet tall. But if they got earplugs in the ears of their spirit, they don't know what you're talking about. They'll testify, they imitate you. Child, you know God sure is good. You know, yeah, he good. You know I played that number last night and hit? Wait a minute. What God you talking about up in here? Mm-hmm. I have actually heard people tell me that they dream the dream, a number, and hit that number. That's right. But who gave them a gambling dream? You see, when you get ready to catch a fish, you cover that hook up with something. Oh, I'm preaching now. Ain't no fish going to bite no naked hook now. I used to hook my bait down so I can spit on it before I put it in the water. I don't know what that means. I just saw my grandpa and my uncle do it. Ew. So what I'm saying to you, everything that look good don't have to taste good. You ever seen some macaroni with all that beautiful cheese melted on it? Oh, God. And smells so good. So you're going to get you a whole lot of it? Oh. But if it don't taste like yours, you go to the tray and try to, when ain't nobody looking, you try to put a little bit. How come? Your spiritual taste buds can see. Old taste and see that the Lord is good and his mercy. And them of such a hey, put up with all your stuff. You know, even now, we're sitting here enjoying the mercy of God. Now, don't let nobody fool you. Nobody is worthy of it. Only by the grace of God that is an unmerited favor. So everything you get from God You got nothing good to give back to God to compensate for the goodness of God. So my subject is the goodness of the Lord. When I was in them joints playing my saxophone, I heard God talk to me. I'd be playing hunky-tunk and cry. That's all. I resist him for years. I knew the voice of God. But I didn't receive his words. Now I receive his words. And when my lawnmower broke down last night at 11 o'clock in the yard out there where there's no light, I heard God say, if I be for you, oh, God Almighty. Two things. Who can be against you? Or if I be for you, I'm more than the whole world that's against you. I didn't know how to make that lawnmower work. I just thought it'd have oil for the motor. I didn't know it had a hydraulic system that didn't carry 5W10. It carried 15W50. And I'm out there in the dark flumming around because I lift the seat. This is the reservoir. This is the seat. The seat was curving the reservoir that needed the oil. Listen to me. And I was sitting on my problem. No, y'all didn't hear me. You didn't hear me. You better get up. My old grandparent used to say, if my mama don't go, I'm going. You got to make your mind up. Listen to me. There ain't nothing that your God don't know. Amen. And most of the stuff that we don't know is his business. So what was I doing? I was sitting on the problem. And the reservoir had a safety valve on it. So when the hydraulic oil got to a certain lowness, it tricked a switch and it cut the power off. So I wouldn't burn the lawnmower. God will look. I didn't know nothing about that. But if it, this is what the Bible say. If any man lack knowledge, what? Let him ask of God to give it to all men liberally. He said, get up off of the seat. I was just cold enough and tired enough to do what he said. That was one step. Lift the seat forward. I lifted forward. He said, take that cap off of that container there. You know when your hand's cold, you don't have much grip. So I had to go in the garage and get a pair of channel locks. Because the channel lock helped me to do what God told me to do. This is your helper. And it was so dark and it didn't have no dipstick. And in the dark, God said, stick your finger down in there. I said, Lord, what? He didn't say nothing else. He ain't gonna keep on telling you. The day you hear my voice, harden not your heart, as in the day of provocation when you provoked to me. So I stuck finger already cold. Listen to me. I got 5 doctor's degrees. I didn't have the common sense to put gloves on my hand if I ever needed the Lord before. And look at the instructions. When I got home, the Lord said, don't run hot water on your hand. I'm talking about how God teach me in the simple stuff. Now, if I had disobeyed God, I would have felt pain. So obedience is what? It's you better hear God. You better, never mind what it's all about. Follow God. He just don't know the way. He is the way. And let me tell you something. He is a fixer. I'm out there in the dark. I don't know what to do to make the thing work. And step by step, and the thief didn't see me because I was out there in the dark. They parked the car right here in the dark, cut their lights off. Now, they wouldn't come into church. Let me show you the power of God. When they drove that old regular Chevrolet up to the end of that parking lot, and I stood up, it took off just like that. Listen to me, it goes two ways. The fear of the Lord is our strength. The fear of the Lord is the sinner's fear. So I stuck my finger down in there. And I came with just a little black tip on there. So that tell me I need this much oil in that reservoir. Now you try to find some 15W50 oil at night. I went to that filling station 3 times. I saw it the first time. Listen to me now, listen. Listen to me. I was so involved with the problem, I didn't see the solution. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. Huh? So I went to all the big stores where I thought they'd have it. God said, go back. Pick up that first can of oil you had. He didn't tell me to get 2, but I bought 2 just in case. I'm trying to tell you how God will solve your natural problems. Now, I had a natural problem in that I didn't know what to do to make the lawnmower work. But I had a spiritual problem because two things were there waiting for me to lead. Now, let me tell you something. My grandmother always told me, Skate, when you try everything and nothing work, try Jesus. That just don't ain't just related to no lawnmower. If you're on a job, your foreman is on your case. Your fellow employees on your case. The last thing you need to do is get angry. You can't hear God good when you're angry. Because the Holy Spirit, listen to me now and learn, the Holy Spirit does not speak to anger. He speaks to your mind. Amen. And he tell your spirit, think on these things. And my grandmother used to put it like this. She put some vinegar on a corn stalk and some syrup on another corn stalk. He took it out to barn where a lot of flies was. And we went back in a couple of hours. She had some sticky stuff on that sweet stuff. That stick was full of flies. And she said, son, yes, sir. You catch more flies with sugar than you do with vinegar. Word of God say, yea. Oh, taste. Yes, Lord Jesus. And you will see that the Lord is good. David said, Lord, your word is sweeter to me than honey in the honeycomb. So what we're learning tonight is how to behave ourselves in the presence of the adversary. And you always going to hear two voices. You always going to hear two voices. But God say, if Baal be God, then serve Baal. But if God be God, then serve him. Joshua said, yeah, as for me and my house, we got a choice. But we're going to all serve the Lord. Somebody wrote a song, he's sweet, I know. Now, you can take serve and get it this close to your mouth. You can't sing that song. To know how sweet Jesus is. Can't get them in your mind. Your mind don't taste, it just talks. You got to get Jesus on your inside. Now listen to me now. That sweet taste that Jesus is a keeper, a counselor, a A friend? Huh? Because the scripture said, oh, taste and you will see that the Lord is good. So our subject is giving thanks unto the Lord. Now we need to understand what the work of the devil is and what the work of the Lord is. They're both working at the same time. And they both are looking for a consequence or a benefit. Now, whatever the devil does that will bring you a negative consequence to him is pleasing. Because he came to steal, kill, and destroy. But the Lord Jesus, I came that you might have life. So there ain't no time in your life that you don't have one choice. You can have but one. This book said, choose you this day whom you will serve. Now, if you got a choice, you don't see no woman go shopping for shoes and put on her first shoes and walk out of there. So if you're going to be a shoe salesman to a woman, you need patience. Now, she ain't going to just buy that shoe because it's fit. Got to look right, too. And them shoes got to go with that other stuff she got in that bag. Huh? He is good. He is bad. The Holy Ghost say, choose you this day whom you will serve. If the devil go along with your colors, good, choose him. But if God can save your husband, your son, your daughter, you, your cousin, why don't you choose him? But it's an open door because the Lord Jesus said, whosoever will, what? Let him come. You got a choice. Listen to me. And salvation depends on who you choose. There's life and death. Choose life. The scriptures say, why should you die? Now, my subject is giving thanks unto God, to the Lord. I heard it all my life. James, everything that look good ain't good. When they got through beating the Lord Jesus, they beat him beyond recognition. He didn't even look like a man. And that was just a small part. I'm talking about the goodness of the Lord. He went to hell for me. Now, hell ain't like paradise. It don't start with no P. Now, I tell you, he went to hell for you. But I know he went to hell for me. We have to testify about the goodness of God for ourselves. Child, you know God sure been what? Good to me. Then you start making a little statement. Well, he kept me last night while I was asleep. You know you don't wake yourself up. Look how simple it is. He woke me up, and I was in my right mind. I knew where the bathroom was. I knew where the kitchen was. Don't take that stuff for granted. Somebody wrote a song, and I got an answer to it. If it were not for the Lord, Lord, what I do? You'd be burning in hell. I am the way. Jesus said it. The truth and the life. No man come to the Father but by me. Is God good? I say, is God good? Now, if you want to get to a good God, you need the proper transportation. Jesus is the answer. Y'all just excuse me. When you're mumbling around trying to find the right words to say, there's only one. Jesus. Now go on to sleep. You stay up all night telling him all about it. He already know all about it. He's waiting on you to come. He ain't gonna come get you. Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. What did he say he'll do? And I'll give you rest. Look at the responsibility. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. And you'll find out I'm meek and lowly in heart. And when you become meek and lowly in heart, you'll find rest for your soul. So the likeness of Christ is rest for our soul. Now you can imitate rest. No, sir. Rest is a man. His name is Jima Kamaseta. His name. You notice how I said Jesus, when I said rest is a man. Don't stop right there. Because some men can take all your little rest away. Amen. I'm so glad to be a part of the family of God. The Lord just told me, tell them, praises is in the reading. Did you hear what God said? Praises is in the reading. And the reading have a threefold subject. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. These three are one. Now put your little brain to work, try to figure that out. Faith tells you, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost is one. Just believe it. And going up there, and he'd tell you all about it later on. I don't want to give you a whole lot of information. I want to give you some simple understanding. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not to your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Don't forget the basic scriptures. If you ain't never been to Arkansas, don't just fill up your car. Fill up your car and get a map. Put your finger where you is and put your finger where you want to be. And then go straight from here to there. As men as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Most of us don't know where heaven is. But let me tell you, heaven came down in glory. You don't have no problem telling folks, you know, he's just full of hell. Well, why don't you say that about the saints? She's just full of heaven. How come we want to say the negative stuff and jump over the positive stuff? Demonic teaching. We say there's never a time when you don't need God. Then somebody write a song. If I ever needed the Lord before. Take that if off. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. So if you have a need, don't think on the need, think on Jesus. He's full of what you need. Come on. Come on here. He's full of what you need. Don't sing these songs that you used to shout on. There will be peace in the valley someday. Yeah, yeah. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He ain't gonna will be. He said, I am. Don't let people take that music. And people shout on that too. Now you listen to me. We ain't big enough to have but one problem at a time. Just one. We save. But the devil got people that is trained to speak against your God. You mean to tell me you so safe if somebody slap your wife, you won't do nothing? You mean if somebody take your baby by the heel and slam his head against and brush his brains out? You mean to tell me somebody breaking your heart? You listen to a demon. What he's trying to do? Put us in intellectual gear. But the Bible says, as a man thinking is what? Huh? You better let that foolishness go on by you. You know, you do your head, you know it's laid. And you come in. Baby, how you like my hair? Oh, it's all right. Now listen. You say, but that ain't gonna make you feel good. What are you thinking about? Your hair? And you forgot to be an heir? He didn't say that you look good. And the Bible says, oh, taste and see that the, not your hair, the lomo como seta. You better keep yourself in biblical gear. Now you need to know the devil don't blow no trumpet before he come to you. So Jesus said, watch. As well as what? You can't pray with your spiritual eyes closed. How come? The devil come to steal. To rob, to steal, and to kill. Now you see his intent. But the other side of that scripture said, yea, but I came That's Jesus talking. That you might have life and have that life more abundantly. It's okay to enjoy life. Because if your life don't have no joy, you got a weak life. Amen. So don't let nobody's lip rob you of the joy of your life. Come on here. You had on that dress last week. And the Bible says you ain't supposed to put no lipstick on your lip. Saints don't wear high heels. Now you think about picking your foot up and taking your high heel and parting his hair. Don't do it. Jesus said, when you live right, I'll make even your enemies be at peace with you. If they refuse to be at peace, I'll make your enemies your footstool. God will deal with your enemy. Our subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. The devil don't speak to you to activate a godly thought. And it don't always seem like a devil. You know, you think you sub. Don't think on that. Don't say, I am. Leave it alone. You got to learn this. See, you went fishing, man. You got this bait on your hook. You throw it out there in the water, and you wiggle it. You move it like, you huh? The devil is evil, but he ain't nobody's fool. Now, what you are now, he don't know. How you live now, he hate. But he got a memory, and he'll remind you of your yesterday. Don't talk to him. I know you got this man, but you ain't always had him. I remember when. Look at him, he's old and bald-headed. Don't talk to the devil. Don't hold a conversation with the enemy. Three words will put that devil where he belongs. Lord, I thank you. Now, when you first start saying it, you might not mean it. You be, Lord, no, not like that. Because we are hindered by the human element, you have to shed your thought about your enemy. You must start thinking about that salvation. The best way, listen to me, the best way to deal with a demon, don't talk. And you come to a place where you don't listen. Because it's the devil's job to generate his thought in your mind. And his mind is vengeance. In the scripture, God said, vengeance what? It's mine. I will repay. Look at him laying there, smelling like somebody else's perfume. Why don't you boil some water? Don't tell me you don't think like that. You better tell the devil going to hell. You know your perfume. You know that ain't none of your perfume. A woman can have 50 perfumes and know every one. He half drunk, sleep. You're going to, what you want to do, Augur? You better go on to sleep. You know what they're called? God called it two things. Mercy and forgiveness. Those two things won't tame the devil to become hot. The devil don't want to be around mercy. He hates forgiveness. So he generate unforgiveness, unmercifulness. That's his job. I just had a vision. You ever seen a bucket resist water? It's just a bucket. You can put anything. You put tar in there, sand in there, mud in there. Choose you this day whom you will serve. If Baal, this false god, be God, then serve him. We got a choice. But if God be God, serve him now. You have to serve the Lord in the beauty of holiness. You need to hear this. You can't serve God out of a spirit of anger. This is forgiveness. Anger will block it. I know he did you wrong. I know she did you wrong. But until you forgive them, you cannot pray for them. Oh, I tell you, God is tight when it comes to that. You laying there. Go and check the water. It's already boiling. We should be singing the song, I got heaven on my... No, you ain't. Stop lying. Here is our prayer. You listen to me now. When the devil come with ungodliness, our prayer is simple and direct. Lord, help me. Then you go in there and cut the water off. Then you come in there. Don't sleep on the couch. That's vengeance. The Lord said, vengeance is mine. I'll repay me como sotaha. I'll repay. This word is right, saints. Listen to me. Listen to me what God say. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Now you're angry. You smell a perfume. See, he drunk. He smelled alcohol. He can't smell that perfume. But you ain't drunk. Where you been? Down to the pool hall. It's 4 o'clock in the morning. Jesus said, forgive and you will be forgiven. If you don't forgive, you will not be forgiven. It's a hard thing, man. That's why I said it's straight and narrow. Few there be though in it. And now if the thing keep repeating itself, you need to talk to God about it. Don't think about the divorce court yet. Think about God. In this Bible say he will direct what? He'll tell you what to do. And you will not be condemned. People might try to condemn you. Huh? Look. But you got to endure to the end. End of what? Your patience. Now, don't try to go 1 centimeter beyond your patience. You'll do something, you'll set him on fire. This is a good prayer at any time. Lord, help me. That's a good prayer. Lord, help me. Subject, giving thanks unto the Lord. I know some folk don't like to hear this book, but this book said, if your enemy hungry, what did he say? He sure did it. He said, Lord have mercy. Now you know what he crucified Jesus. If your enemy hunger, feed him. Now don't forget this now. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Look what he said. I will direct your path. When God direct your path, don't you let folk condemn you. Amen. Because anytime you obey God, you got to be right. I didn't say popular. Some person come to our Bible college on Tuesday night, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He said, Pastor, I tried to get the people to come, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I said, what'd they tell you? I ain't going down there with that. That worst hour in and ain't talking about night either. Only thing we do here is read. And when you read, you begin to hear. And faith come by, not reading, the ears of your spirit. We're in Jeremiah 1. And we're saying that you can hear and get saved at any age, because out of the mouth of suckling and babes, God have ordained perfect praise. They ain't even walking yet. Jeremiah 1, I'm going to read again. The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were in Antioch, in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign, the word of the Lord, it came also in the days of Jehoiakim. So, God just don't speak to you once in the presence of one group. Amen. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, unto the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah. See, he naming the people, the time, the year, who was king, who was not king. He pinpointing the word. Fourth verse, Jeremiah 1. Then the word of the Lord came unto me. See, God spoke to Jeremiah to speak to this person. He spoke to Jeremiah to speak to that person. Then he spoke to Jeremiah about Jeremiah. The boy's only 8 years old now, and these are kings he's talking to. Jeremiah 1:4. Then, which means after some accident happened, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed you in the belly. You hear people say God is an all-knowing God. He knew you before you got here. Where were you? In his mind. I knew you. And before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified. Here's a baby ain't born yet and sanctified. What does that mean, filled with the Holy Ghost? And I ordain you a prophet unto the nations, two nations, Israel and Judah. Israel had 10 tribes, Judah had two, 2 times 2 plus 10 is 12. Then said I, oh Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I'm a child. Look to God's reaction to that. Jeremiah 1:7. But the Lord said unto him, say not to me, I'm a child. Don't you tell me you're a child. For you shall go to all that I shall send you. Look, no. You need to get this, preachers. And whatsoever I command you, you shall speak. That's called a message from God. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with you. Lord, I like this here. To deliver you, said the Lord. Didn't send him by Jeremiah's mother and father, did he? Just 80-year-old boy. Sent him to a whole rebellious nation. The Lord put forth his hand and touched my what? He didn't know what to say. No preacher know what to say. That's why you should read. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. Now, if that ain't a message from God, glory. So you don't have no testimony if God didn't give it to you. You don't have no message if God didn't give it to you. So where does the message come from? God. About whom? Jesus. See? Jeremiah 1:10. I have this day set you over the nation, an 8-year-old boy that didn't even know the voice of God. And over the kingdoms, 8 years old now, to root out, to pull down, and to destroy, and throw down, and to build, and to plant. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? And I said, I see the rod of an almond tree. He's only 8 years old. The almond tree didn't exist. He saw it. Call it a prophecy. Then the Lord said unto me, you have well seen. Look. For I will hasten my word to perform what you saw that was not there. God working with an 80-year-old boy over a whole nation. And the word of the Lord came to me the second time saying, what see you? What do you see? And I said, I see a seeding pot. And the faith thereof is toward the north. Then the Lord said unto me, out of the north an evil shall break forth upon all inhabitants of the land. For lo, I will call all the families of the kingdom of the north, saith the Lord, and they shall come, and they shall set every one his throne at the entering of the gate of Jerusalem, and against all the walls thereof round about, and against all the cities of Judah. I'm going to bring judgment upon all the people that are called by my name. And I will utter my judgment against them, touching all that wickedness who have forsaken me and have burned incense to other God and worshiped the works of their own hand. You therefore, gird up your loins and arise
and speak unto them all that I command you. Be not dismayed at their faces, lest I confound you before them. When God give you a word, he means you deliver it. For behold, 18 verse in Jeremiah 1, I have made you this day a defense city and an iron pillar, brazen walls against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, against the princes thereof, against the peace priests thereof, against the people of the land. And they shall fight against you. Anytime you preach holiness, you're going to have enemies. But they shall not prevail against you. For I am with you, said the Lord, to deliver you. You need to keep that in your mind. When you live and preach what God told you to live and preach, everybody going to be against you but those that love the Lord. So don't look for no 20,000 member church. Look, let your eyes look straight on to Jesus. I am Pastor Dr. James L. Wheeler. I pastor the Full Gospel Christian Church at 5901 Dr. Martin Luther King at Home Avenue, three blocks north of Pearson Road, where you're always welcome. We're on Channel 17 television. Sunday, 8 a.m., Monday, 10 a.m., Wednesday, 12 noon, Wednesday, 9 p.m., Thursday, 12:30 p.m., Saturday, 1 p.m., Saturday again at 7.